Information, please. Presented each week at this time by Canada Dry, famous the world over for its fine beverages. Wake up, America. Time to stump the experts and enjoy a glass of cool, refreshing Canada Dry ginger ale. Every week at this time, Canada Dry stages its own inquisitive inquisition with four experts as the willing victims. Here's how it goes. For every question we use, whether or not it's answered correctly, the sender gets $5. And if your question stumps our board of experts, you not only get $10 more, but in addition you receive a complete 24-volume set of the current Encyclopedia Britannica. Mind you, this is only if your question stumps our board of experts. Our editorial staff may reword your question a trifle. Don't worry about it. Whenever there is a duplication of questions, Information Please uses the one that was received first. All questions become the property of Information Please and should be addressed to Canada Dry, 1 Pershing Square, New York City, or in Canada, Canada Dry, Toronto. At this point, I usually present Mr. Clifton Fadiman, our master of ceremonies. I regret to announce, though, that Mr. Fadiman has been taken ill and will not be with us tonight. So we are calling upon Mr. Adams to give up his expert's chair and assume Mr. Fadiman's role as master of ceremonies for this evening. Believe it or not, Mr. Adams, you are master of ceremonies.
That ought to cure Mr. Fadiman, no matter what he's got.
If you don't mind, Mr. Adams, I will read Mr. Fadiman's usual introduction while you are pulling yourself together.
I'll pull myself apart as far as that goes.
Well, if you do, a cool glass of Canada Dry will pick you up, as they say. Ladies and gentlemen, the questions that you are about to hear have not been seen or heard before by any of the experts. This is a cast iron guarantee. Everything you hear on this program is completely ad lib. The ad-libbers this evening are the eminent sports expert, John Kieran, the composer and author, Oscar Levant, and as our guests, the distinguished journalist and biographer, Alva Johnston, and the Pulitzer Prize-winning playwright and producer, Mark Connolly. Remember, listeners, for each question that is missed, Canada Dry rings up $10, which is paid out to the sender, plus 24 volumes of the latest edition of the Encyclopedia Britannica. All right, Mr. Adams, you can start with question number one.
Question number one comes from Mary W. Gardner of Coronado, California. The question is, what toy wrote poetry, was the hero of a movie, and was named after a president? Three questions, you're asked to get two out of three. What toy wrote poetry? Raise your hands if you know the answer.
You see any hands?
I see no hands, whatever. Well, what toy was the hero of a movie? Mr. Connolly.
Pinocchio.
Correct. And what toy was named after a president? Mr. Johnston.
Teddy bear.
That's right. And so that question is all right. And we missed one. The toy that wrote poetry was Winnie the Pooh, the toy bear of A.A. Milne's The House at Pooh Corner. Mr. L. Daniels of Indianapolis, Indiana, asks, if you wanted to see these fights, staged without the Queensberry rules, where would you have gone? Vincent versus Sweeney. Mr. Levant.
I'm not sure, but how about Washington, D.C.? Is that right?
That's right, but how about it? What, you know any of the details of the fight?
Well, I think it was two representatives, one of them called Sweeney and the other called Vincent, and it must have been a debate about conscription. There was... Is that right?
That's exactly right. It's wonderful.
Thank you, Daddy.
Brooks versus Sumner. Mr. Johnston.
The Senate of the United States. Brooks hit Sumner with the club several times and laid him out back in 1855 or something of that kind.
May 22nd, 1856. Pretty close. Giordano versus Margacus.
Ooh, what a pronunciation. That's Major Kurth.
Major Kurth.
Sorry, Mr. Adams. Well, I was in Brooklyn. That was due to a rabid Brooklyn fan who didn't like a decision by Major Kurth, which... Well, you don't want me to go into that. That's dangerous ground.
You don't remember the date, do you?
It was last week.
It was last week, September 16th. Mm-hmm. Miriam Weiss of Memphis, Tennessee... asks you to name the fictional character who married to get himself a new car, that he might win an election for mayor, and because his future wife could stand on her head on the butt end of a spear, with fireworks going off all around, 2 out of 3 you're asked to get.
What's the first?
The first is to name the fictional character who married to get himself a new car. Mr. Levant?
It's not in... Well, it could... The boy who threw the ball all the time against the wall in Tobacco Road.
Yeah.
What's his name? Dude?
Mr. Johnston?
Dude Lester, I think.
I don't know his
Dude
name.
Dude Lester in Tobacco Lester. Road is right. Little collaboration, but good. And who is the fictional character who married in order that he might win an election for mayor? Mr. Johnston?
The Great McGetty.
Right. And who, because his future wife could stand on her head on the butt end of a spear with fireworks going off all around?
What did he marry her for? I don't get that.
Do you know 5 better reasons? You can... 4 out of 5 is good enough for that. That's a well-known
Is she still
character.
Living? There was an English humorist who wrote a book. Am I close?
You're pretty close.
Now, wait a minute. He wrote One in America. Is that the same fella?
That is not the same fella.
Well, I'm not close.
You've got 2 out of 3 anyway. But this happens to be Mr. Vincent Crummles, who married Mrs. Crummles in Nicholas Nickleby. And when 5 better reasons are made for marriage, Mr. Dickens will probably write them. Mr. Irving G. Smith of Denver asks what presidential candidate was pictured by cartoonists with a large package of newspapers protruding from his coat pocket. There are 4 of these, and you're asked to get 3. With a large package of newspapers protruding from his coat pocket. Well known in cartoons at the time.
Is that around McKinley's time? Just asking now.
I'm asking questions here.
I know Theodore Roosevelt was always pictured with the magazine sticking out of his pocket, the magazine of which he was editor.
You don't mean the Outlook?
I do.
Well, that was not a large package of newspapers protruding from his coat pocket.
Depends on how you like the Outlook.
Horace Greeley.
Horace Greeley of what newspaper?
The New York Tribune.
Of which we are alumni. With ostrich feathers protruding from the top of his hat. Mr. Johnston.
James G. Blaine.
James G. Blaine, known as the Plumed Knight. Carrying a cudgel.
T.R. Roosevelt.
Theodore Roosevelt, and why?
The big stick, which he shook at malefactors. Great will.
And who was pictured as a schoolmaster wearing a mortarboard? Mr. Connolly.
Woodrow Wilson.
That's all right. We will now present, from G. Morton of Detroit, a love scene in music. The dialogue is contained in the titles of the songs to be played by our pianist. Can you tell what the boy says and what the girl says? Music cue.
Let me call you, sweetheart.
Raise your hand. Mr. Connolly.
I'm just wild about Harry.
Hands, please. Mr. Levant.
What'll I do?
That's right.
This would have been a good one for Mr. Adams.
I'd love to be on that other side. And what is that? Mr. Levant.
Might be your once in a while, Lottie.
That's right.
Did you sing that originally?
Never. Never heard of it.
It's a Rogers and Hart song.
Mr. Connolly, what would that be?
I'm expecting for some quick help from Mr. Levant.
It's from Babes in Arms.
Babes in Arms.
Where or?
When.
That's right.
Thank you.
That's a nice little collaboration. There's another one. Mr. Connolly.
There's a little... We'll have a little nest in flat... Little flat in Flatbush by Pelham Granville Woodhouse.
Well, that's pretty close. When it's nesting time in Flatbush, and that was guessed 100%.
Well, Jerome Kern wrote the music, incidentally.
I only know the lyric.
Well, didn't he write the music?
Yes,
he wrote the music. You were asked to name four famous people whose names mean political or geographical divisions, as, for instance, Carrie Nation.
Senator Gerry.
Well, that's right.
The inventor of the gerrymander.
That's right. Mr. Levin.
Rudy Valley. Well, Valley. Is that a division or a portion?
I think that's a geographical division. Mr. Kieran.
Kennesaw Mountain Landis.
That's fine. Any more?
Man Mountain Dean.
We've got to get another one. No, that wouldn't work.
ABC.
Oh, yeah. Manufacturer. Edgar Rice Burroughs.
That's right. That's a good one. How about Artemus Ward?
How about Simeon Lake?
We're getting Simeon into politics Lake. Now.
How about our old buddy Mo Berg?
Yeah.
Are you answering these questions?
Then you could get a couple more. You get Temple Bailey and Myron C. Wick. How do you like that, Mark?
A marriage can be arranged.
I suppose you think there is no such person as Myron C. Wick. He lives in Cleveland and he's in Republic Steel.
I'm your guest.
How about Hill Brothers Coffee? No.
As we pause before our plunge into the second half, we find that Canada Dry has paid out zero in money and no sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica to erudite question framers. All right, Mr. Cross, shoot.
According to the calendar, autumn has finally arrived, which means that we move indoors for our evening entertainment. Soon the usual fall dances will take place, and as always, the crowd will gather at the refreshment table where sparkling Canada Dry Water will be the ruling club soda. Canada Dry Water will never be a wallflower at the party or dance because it is so well liked by everybody. For one thing, it makes your favorite drink taste better, and its millions of extra bubbles keep the drink lively and sparkling for a good long time. So when you dance over and stop at the refreshment table, always pour your club soda from the platinum-colored bottle with the silver top, the Canada Dry bottle. Your drink itself will dance in the glass when the soda is Canada Dry.
Thank you, Mr. Cross. Your cogent advice was delivered in what seemed to me 3 seconds. In the second half of this entertainment, Mrs. William E. Tower of Meshanticut, Rhode Island, asked you to name the books or poems about characters who traveled in these unusual conveyances. And I don't understand how we haven't lost any money. When I'm up there, we lose money. A mummy case. Mr. Connolly.
An actress in The Man Who Came to Dinner.
Correct. A rocket. You only have to get 3 out of 4 of these. A rocket.
Baron
Mr.
Munchausen.
Connolly again.
Baron Munchausen.
Well, I wouldn't know about that. That isn't on the card here.
What do you mean, a rocket? A conveyance? A rocket to the moon type?
Something like that, yes.
Well, Mickey Mouse has made several trips on rockets.
Buck Rogers was doing it 300 years
That's
ago.
That's on the films, isn't it?
Yes.
I wouldn't know about it.
Rocket.
A rocket? Why, I should think you'd know that.
Well, we don't.
Well, you don't have to. That is in a book called From the Earth to the Moon and Around the Moon by Jules Verne. A wooden shoe. Mr. Kieran.
Three mariners, Winkin', Blinkin', and Nod.
And what did they do?
sailed off in a wooden shoe.
Correct. Author?
Your friend from Indiana.
Field.
No, Eugene no. Field.
Right? Yeah, Eugene Field.
My friend from...
Chicago,
another place.
I beg your pardon.
A bowl. Mr. Connolly?
Three wise men of Gotham.
That's right. Any more? You know how it goes after that? I'm just asking.
I think so.
They went to sea in it. I haven't got any transatlantic reports.
Well, I think that's probably censored now. Miss or Mrs. Ruth Match, as the case may be, from San Bernardino, California, says that each of these men directed a film with a one-word title that suggests strong feeling. Name the film. For example, Eric von Stromheim directed...
Greed.
Greed. D.W. Griffith? Mr. Johnston?
Intolerance.
Intolerance. Fritz Lang?
M.
Fury.
Fury is right.
M doesn't connote any strong feeling, does it?
Fury?
No letter words.
Nobody knows better than you. Ernst Lubitsch.
With only one word?
Mr. Johnston?
Passion.
Passion. Frank Borzage, maybe that's the way it's pronounced.
Borzage.
Borzage.
I think I'm wrong, too. It's Borzage, isn't it?
Yes, Borzage.
B-O-R-Z-A-G-E.
Let him write in.
Let him talk to my lawyer. Well, what is it? You don't have to guess it because you guessed three.
What was that picture with Dietrich in? You know all her pictures, Mr. Adams.
Huh? I never heard of her even.
Yeah.
Morocco?
No, Morocco was Sternberg. What?
Don't quibble.
You might not call this a strong passion.
Well, what is it?
Desire.
That was a trap.
Mr. John R. Vail of Montclair, New Jersey, says that most of us are required at various times to be registered with government agencies. Can you name five such agencies that have a record of your name? Mr. Kieran.
Well, I can start. The Bureau of Motor Vehicles in New York State, for one. The Bureau of Vital Statistics in New York State, for two.
That would be the Department of Health, very likely.
Well, I won't quibble about that. United States Army records have one on a lot of us.
Library of Congress.
And the city directory has a record of us. And the United States...
That is the government agency.
United States Census has a record of us. That probably comes under the head of the Bureau of Agriculture in our case.
That's true.
What about the federal income tax?
The Department of Internal Revenue.
Well, you
Revenue.
May be on
That's
that,
right.
Mr. Levant.
You're on it, too.
You're not boasting, are you?
No. How about if you're on parole? Where do you register?
I don't know. Where is that, Connolly? There are also the Board of Elections to three of you boys. I don't know about the minor.
The copyright.
And anybody that's traveled may have something in the Department of State.
Passport.
Well, that's pretty good. I don't understand how... how we don't lose any dough. Mrs. May Gallagher of Brooklyn asked you to name the champion heavyweight boxers who acted in these plays. You have to get two out of three, and if you don't get three out of three, I'm angry. Gentleman Jack. Mr. Levant.
You might get angry. Was that Corbett?
That was Corbett.
Yeah.
And William A. Brady was one of the collaborators of the show, as a matter of fact. Honest Hearts and Willing Hands. Mr. Johnston.
Jeffries.
I think that was Bob Fitzsimmons.
Well, I'll take it.
John L. Sullivan. Yeah. And I saw the play, and it was beautiful. The Honest Blacksmith.
That was Fitzsimmons.
That was Fitzsimmons.
Yeah, the freckle-faced Cornishman.
He played the lead.
And the cowboy and a lady.
The Anvil Chorus.
Are you angry?
Mr. Julius Landown of Brooklyn asks you to complete the following. This is the first part of a couplet. Thus grief still treads upon the heels of pleasure. Goody, 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 they don't know.
Marry in haste or repent at leisure?
That's exactly right, Mr. Johnson. You know who wrote it?
Congreve.
Goodness. He did. To swallow gudgeons ere they're catched.
It sounds finished the way it is.
There's another line of that couplet, a way that couplets have.
That would be a good one again for you.
It's something about eggs unhatched.
I'd put in here, give you that. To swallow gudgeons ere they're catched and count their chickens ere they're hatched. Samuel Butler.
Hudibras.
Hudibras. I kind of think I'd give him that. You only have to get 2 out of 3 anyway. Large streams from little fountains flow. Mr. Kieran.
Great oaks from little acorns grow.
Well, that's pretty close. It's tall oaks.
Tall oaks.
You know the whole poem? How it begins?
No, but do you have to say it?
Yeah. I don't have to say it, but I remember it ain't even here. You'd scarce expect one of my age to speak in public on the stage, is the way it begins.
Well, don't
stop. That's a prologue, I believe, by Oliver Wendell Holmes.
Well, it's got a very good title to the poem, and I think I'd like to write a poem by that because it'll take up an awful lot of space with the title. This is by David Everett, and the title of the poem is Lines Written for a School Declamation for Ephraim H. Farrer, age 7, New Ipswich, N.H. I think that's a dandy title, especially if you put it in electric lights. Mr. Carl D. Blows of Birdsboro, Pennsylvania, asks what the following pairs of people have in common. Benjamin Franklin and Mr. Dick and David Copperfield. Mr. Connolly.
They were both historians.
Well, maybe they were, but I don't know that. What do you think, Mr.
They're
Johnson?
Both kite flyers.
They were both kite flyers. Dick Whittington and the Marquis of Carrabas. Mr. Kieran was up first.
They both grew prosperous through association with cats.
That's right. And where did Carrabas get his...
From Puss in Boots.
That's right. That's 2 out of 3. Do you want to get this pushover, Mr. Connolly?
By all means.
Jack and Jill and the King of France. I won't take no for an answer. Well, Mr. K.
Why, they marched up a hill. Each went up a hill.
That's right, 2 hills. Well, I'm glad it hasn't cost me a nickel so far. Mrs. Irving S. Underhill in Buffalo wants to know in what famous paintings do these objects appear. I'd like to know, too. A large seashell. Mr. Connolly.
In Botticelli, The Birth of Venus.
That's right. A wheelbarrow. Mr. Connolly again.
I think there's a wheelbarrow in the Angelus.
There is a wheelbarrow in the Angelus. Painted by?
Millet.
A footstool.
A study in gray and white by Whistler.
I think it is an arrangement in black and
arrangement
white.
Arrangement in black and white.
But that's the thing. Known as the mother on the stamps.
Rape.
Mr. Louis Berman of Buffalo asks this, and here goes the money. If a young man distributing cream tarts in a number of bars around town were to take you to his club, where would he take you?
To a milk bar.
You got to raise your hand if you want to answer a silly thing like that.
I was just thinking out loud. Is that right, a milk bar?
No, this is a bit of fiction.
Oh, I thought it was a dairy ad. That'd
be the Whalen.
Say it again.
If a young man distributing cream tarts in a number of bars around town were to take you to his club, where would he take you? To what club? Mr. Conway.
The drones.
Hmm?
The drones.
The suicide club.
Oh, yes.
In the New Arabian Nights by Stevenson. If a man about town took you to a club where he introduced you to crumpets, eggs, and beans, what club would you visit?
We're not clubmen, evidently.
Is that Sam Goldwyn? Tea and trumpet?
No, sir. That's the drones with Bertie Wooster, Eggs, Beans, and Crumpets by P.G. Wodehouse. If a man took you to a club so exclusive that no new member had been elected in years, where would he take you?
I know that one.
Where would he take you?
That's by Max Beerbohm and Zelega Dobson. I've forgotten the name of that very exclusive. He was the only member.
That's right.
What was the name of that club?
Well, it says the J-U-N-T-A, and I think that's pronounced Junta, but I think it ought to be Hunter.
In Colorado,
because
it's
you wouldn't
Hunter.
Say the jorn of the Junta was heard on the hill. Mr. Cross, right now we're waiting to hear from you.
We like to refer to Canada Dry Ginger Ale as the all-occasion drink, for it is really just that. Canada Dry is ideal with meals. The wholesome qualities of real Jamaica ginger are kind to the digestive system. It's delightful as a mid-morning or mid-afternoon pickup, for it has a thirst-quenching sparkle that's refreshing, gingivating. It is so pure and wholesome, you can let the children have all they want, for Canada Dry is often recommended by doctors for convalescents. And, of course, when guests come in, that emerald green bottle labeled with the map of Canada is always a welcome sight. Yes, Canada Dry is an all-occasion drink. So pure, so wholesome, so delightfully good, that is known everywhere as the champagne of ginger ales.
With all the statistics in, we find Canada Dry shy $10 and one set of the Encyclopedia Britannica, which goes to Mr. Louis Berman of Buffalo, New York, with the last question. And now, Mr. Cross, take over. I'm tired.
Well, then, may I say thank you, Mr. Connolly and Mr. Johnston, for coming to bat for us this evening. Next week, we will have on hand that trinity of terrifying Titanic intelligences, Mr. Levant, Mr. Kieran, and Mr. Adams.
Goody, goody, goody.
And as our guest, the brilliant playwright, author of The Women, Claire Booth, whose new book, Europe in the Spring, is just out. Don't forget, for every question we use, whether or not it's answered correctly, the sender gets $5. And if your question stumps our board of experts, you not only get $10 more, but in addition a complete 24-volume set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Remember, send your letters with questions and the correct answers to Canada Dry, 1 Pershing Square, New York City. Among the host of Canada Dry beverages, you are bound to enjoy these favorites: Canada Dry Tom Collins Mixer and Canada Dry Lime Ricky, both made with genuine fruit base and the finest ingredients, no preservatives or artificial flavoring. So for delicious, cooling, tall drinks, insist on Canada Dry's Tom Collins Mixer and Canada Dry Lime Ricky. The family size costs only 15 cents, plus bottle deposit. This is Milton Cross saying goodnight for Canada Dry until next week at this same time.